Go, Peeper.
Okay.
Hello. Welcome to Cooking with Real Vegans.
So what are we having for dinner?
Oh, tonight we're going to have this interesting dish, which I will try to pronounce, Ribollita, it's something to that. It's this lovely bean stew, but it's not really a stew, it's kind of a soup, but it's a stew. It's really thick and hearty, and it's really good for a cold time of year, which actually, here it is, May 20-something, and it's still cold in Vermont. So you know what, we're making it tonight. Kimberly? Here from Maryland is going to be creating this wonderful combination of ingredients, which I have to say is, I never thought it would be this good, but it's unbelievable. So I hope you enjoy it, and let's take it away to Kimberly.
Hello, we're going to make ribollita tonight. Ribollita in Italian means reboiled. So without further ado, I will tell you how we're going to make this wonderful meal. We first start with white Great Northern beans, although any white or light bean will do. We have onions that are chopped. We have 3 or 4 celery ribs that are chopped, up to you how much you like to put in. We have 3 carrots that are chopped. We use kale, we use a lot of garlic, and we use 4 potatoes. You can use white potatoes, you can use red potatoes, you can use Yukon Gold potatoes. It doesn't really matter. We also use vegetable broth. This recipe originally came out of an episode of Runner's World magazine, and it's used by marathoners as a pre-race meal. So it's very hearty, it's full of good carbs and protein. So, without further ado, I will start with showing you the white beans. We use 1.5 cups of whole white beans. We also have 1.5 cups or 1 15-ounce can of white beans. And what we do with one of the cans is we put it in a bowl or a plate and we mash it with the back of a spoon or a fork. And the process of mashing allows the beans to collapse, and this is going to be the thickener in the ribollita and allows it to take on a really nice texture. We have kale. And in with the kale, we remove the ribs and we rip up the kale into bite-sized pieces. But once they're cooked, they're going to basically collapse down into nothing. So you just don't want to use the whole kale leaf. You want to be able to rip them into smaller pieces because it makes it easier when you saute the kale. I am going to chop up some onion. And then once we start sauteing the onion, we're going to add garlic and we're going to add rosemary.
Listen, we're not doing canned beans.
I agree with Aaron that using a pressure cooker is absolutely best, but we all know that for some people time is an absolute precious commodity. So for those of you who feel that they can't or they're unable to, a canned bean will double just fine. But just please be aware that canned beans do have a little higher sodium than a dried bean that you cook yourself.
Kimberly likes to do it with the canned beans for her reasons, and I prefer to use the pressure cooker because when you use a pressure cooker, you are containing all the nutrients within the bean. There is so much that goes into making the canned beans. So we're talking about all these things where you could just get the dried bean, put it in here, and then you cook it for about 30 minutes, and you're set. So I prefer the pressure cooker. But if you don't have a pressure cooker, use the canned beans. Kimberly? Kimberly?
We should go make it ourselves.
Let's
go make it ourselves.
It's the old anarchist in the kitchen.
That's it. All right, what do they do in here? Mash. All right, these are mash. And then the onion.
There's a bowl of chopped onion.
Okay. We have to start cooking.
Hell's bells.
All right, the garlic.
Ribollita.
That's a lot of onions, boy.
Yep.
All right, well, this is going to take a while. This is a lot of onions in here. And frankly, never enough oil.
You're right.
Alright. But don't tell them.
Nope.
Okay. Alright, well, the onions are going to take a very long time. Maybe by now.
Alright, that cooks for 20 minutes, like that, stirring occasionally.
20 minutes?
Well, yeah, that's...
Oh, once I get this, it's in there. Hey, up here. Alright, I'm putting the garlic in, I don't care.
Good.
It's going in, because it's Crank the anarchist for Bolito. Oh my god, that smells so good. Alright, what goes next? Back.
So I went to the
garden
just for a minute, and I see that the stove was stolen. So I hope to God that they remembered to tell you that in the beginning it's really important to get those onions sautéing with the garlic and the rosemary, but you don't want to get them to the point where they're fully cooked, because it's at that point when you put the kale in. So you're only going to cook that about halfway, and then you're going to start with the kale. The way that I do that is different from the recipe, but it has been my experience that adding the kale little by little until it collapses down is going to yield you with much better flavor. So please add the additional time. So this stage will probably take you anywhere from 10 to 15 minutes, depending on how much kale you have. In the recipe, it says one bunch kale. But generally, I will always put in two, because kale, in addition to tasting really good, is a great source of minerals such as vitamin C, iron, and things like that. So I use double the kale. If you are forced to use dried rosemary, and I hope to God you're not, please find a way to put it into a little coffee grinder and hit it so that it gets all chopped up, and so essentially it will just dissolve into the broth, because otherwise you'll be picking it out of your teeth, and nobody wants to do that.
Oh, so you can eat it ground up?
Yeah. What's important about this recipe is to understand, make it one time according to the recipe, and then you're going to find that certain flavors you like more and certain flavors you might like less. I like everything, so I put extra garlic in, extra rosemary, extra carrots, extra potatoes, because I work a lot of hours and it's really lovely to come back to the house and have this waiting for me in a pot. So the more I make on Sunday afternoon, the more I have during the week. The next thing you want to do is add to the pot the potatoes, the carrots, the white beans that are both smashed and whole, and then you're going to go ahead and add in some vegetable broth. As far as the tomatoes go, we have canned tomatoes. Right now we're using Rotel tomatoes in a can, and this particular can of Rotel has diced tomatoes and green chilies in it. The recipe doesn't call for green chilies, but if you have a flair for a little unusual, you can put that in. If you want to use plain, you're certainly welcome to use plain tomatoes. I promise you, this looks horrific now, but it's going to taste lovely later on. So here I'm putting in the potatoes and the celery and the carrots. I'm also going to add the beans. And let me tell you something. When you put this all in at once, it's going to be a big, blobby mess. And so what that means is you have to just have the temerity to stir and stir and stir. And so right now I have the vegetable broth in the pot, and I'm stirring to get all of the smashed up beans dissolved into the water, because I said earlier, this is going to make it thick. Hey pal, up here, huh? So, as I said, we're dissolving white beans. And the final step is to add the tomatoes. And right now, the rigolita is very raw. It's not gonna taste like a whole lot of anything. So what we're gonna do is, after we get everything mixed in, we're gonna put this on simmer, not a namby-pamby simmer, but a nice macho simmer. So it will get everything cooking, and once it gets to very close to a boil, then you pull it down to a low simmer. And then you're gonna put the top on the pot, and it's gonna cook away for at least 45 minutes to an hour. And it's at that point when you'll see the broth go from very thin to very thick and to to have a lot of body. Now, we are going to raise the heat just a little bit and try to bring this to a high simmer. As you're cooking the ribollita, you're going to notice that the fluid is going to cook down, and this is going to get thick. It's really important to understand that if you feel like you need to add more vegetable broth, please do. If you've run out of vegetable broth, it's okay to use water, because the flavors that are in the vegetables and the kale and everything will infuse it anyway. So just keep an eye on it. Now, when you put it in the refrigerator overnight, it's going to get really, really thick. So you're going to have to add a little more vegetable broth or water to thicken it up when you reheat it as well.
Second day is always better.
Always, always better. Yeah. The second day is always better. Okay, so now everything is in the pot, and it's ready to cook for 45 minutes minimum. When the ribollita cooks, you want it on a high simmer initially till it gets just about to boil. And when you hear the top moving a little bit, move it down to a low simmer. The liquid is going to condense during this period of time, and it's going to get a little thicker. And that's the point at which everything starts to meld together, and you'll really smell it in the house. And this was once described to me like a bowl of love, and it's like a warm hug. So you will feel and smell all of this in your house when you cook this. And don't be afraid to look at it throughout the 45 minutes or an hour, because it's okay. You're not breaking any laws if you take the top off of it. Yay! Dinner time!
It's done. It's perfect. This is the perfect potato. I just bit into it. It is excellent. And I tasted the broth as well.
It's nice and luxurious.
It's ready to roll.
It's got a nice
all right, let's
slide.
Get the table. All right. Yeah, have some pepper, Ed. How is it?
The only difference that I notice is the little bang from the chili. Whenever you cook with something
stuff
that has a heat element to it, whether it's a red pepper dried or a chili pepper, the heat element will always bloom with the more temperature heat you apply to it. So if you choose to use the Rotel with the green chilies, be aware that your ribollita will have a little kick to it.
Good evening. Tonight, I decided to talk about breasts. I have pretty big ones, I always have, and they've served me very well through my life, I might add. But surprisingly, they have never given milk. Now, maybe you might think that's really not so surprising because you figure I've never had a baby, and you're right. I've never been pregnant, I've never had a baby, so my breasts have never given milk. And that's true because I'm a mammal. And you know who else is a mammal? A cow. The breasts of female cows don't give milk just for the hell of it. They give milk because they've had a baby, and they have to feed their baby. So anytime you drink milk, you're drinking the food of someone else's baby. When we were in Maryland, we would hear when the farmers took the calves away from the mothers so that they could take the milk. It was usually a few days after they were born, and for days after, we heard the mothers crying and crying. And some might say that's a coincidence, and that's conceivably true. But the reality is, it might not be a coincidence. And it might be that the mothers were devastated that their babies were torn away from them. The lives of the babies are worse. If they're male, they live a short, miserable life in a veal factory, or increasingly, they're just killed because veal is not quite as profitable as it used to be. If they're female cows, they enter the cycle of dairy production all over again. There is no good way to make a breast give milk except to make the female pregnant. And to get the milk, you have to take the baby. So when you think about things like the strolling of the heifers in Brattleboro coming up, celebrating the breasts of female cows because they supposedly just give milk whenever we want it, and whenever you're thinking about that cheese or that milkshake you're going to have, think for a minute about breasts and how they serve a purpose or not. And the only purpose is to feed a baby.
You are an instigator, Mr. Ed.
He is.
Okay. We're doing dried beans. We're not going to even talk about camera.
Yes. Can I say that on camera?
Say it again.
Are you filming this?
Hit it right back.
You filmed the whole goddamn thing.
Hit it right back, Nancy.
I did.
I know these things.